Approaching the Buddhist Path, Volume 1, written by Bhikṣu Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama, and Bhikṣuṇī Thubten Chodron, narrated by Peter Aronson. Prologue by His Holiness the Dalai Lama. The world we live in is very different from the world at the Buddha's time, yet we human beings have the same afflictions and still experience physical and mental suffering. While the truth of the Buddha's teachings transcends historical eras, the way they are presented to practitioners in a given time is influenced by the specific culture, environment, and economic and political challenges. I encourage us to become 21st century Buddhists, people whose view is rooted in the Buddha's message of compassion and wisdom, and who also have a broad understanding of many fields, such as science, especially neurology, psychology, and physics, and other religions. Our Buddhist knowledge must be expansive, not limited to just one topic, practice, or Buddhist tradition. We should try to learn about the teachings and practices of other Buddhist traditions and understand how they suit the particular dispositions and interests of the people who practice them. We may also include some of these teachings in our own practice. In this way, we will better appreciate the Buddha's skill as a teacher, which will reduce the sectarianism that limits us Buddhists from acting together to contribute to the welfare of all peoples and environments on our planet. We should also understand the full path to awakening and how different teachings can be practiced by the same individual at different points of his or her spiritual journey. This will clarify our personal practice, as well as increase our respect for all Buddhist traditions and other religions. To grow these understandings in ourselves, reciting prayers and mantras is not sufficient. While perhaps increasing our devotion, these activities alone do not bring wisdom. In the modern world, we need to be realistic and practical, and for this, knowledge is essential. All of us want happiness, not suffering. Since both happiness and suffering arise in dependence on causes and conditions, we must know the causes of each so that we can train our minds to create the causes for happiness and abandon the causes for suffering. All of us want a harmonious society. Since society consists of individuals, to bring about peace, each individual must cultivate peace in his or her own heart and mind. Of course, the ultimate aim of the Buddha's teachings goes beyond world peace to liberation from all rebirth and cyclic existence, samsara. But the teachings can help us create a more peaceful society while we are still in cyclic existence. The material in this series accords with the general presentation of the Indian sages of the Nalanda tradition, who are held in esteem by all four Buddhist traditions in Tibet, as well as Buddhist traditions in China. Most of the quoted passages come from these Indian sources, and in terms of the method aspect of the path, renunciation, bodhicitta, and the perfections of generosity, ethical conduct, fortitude, joyous effort, and meditative stability, there is little difference among them. Tibetan traditions follow Nagarjuna and speak of the non-contradictory nature of emptiness and dependent arising as the essence of the wisdom aspect of the path. Here, we will emphasize Tsongkhapa's presentation of emptiness and sometimes mention teachings from the Nyingma, Kagyu, and Sakya traditions. Because the Pali tradition emphasizes the fundamental vehicle, which is common to all Buddhist traditions, we also cite passages from it. In general, my teaching style does not follow the approach of the traditional Lam Rim, stages of the path teachings. I like to speak a lot about emptiness and show its relationship to other aspects of the path. This way of presenting the teachings also flourished in ancient India. Many years ago, His Eminence Geshe Lundik Namgyal, the Ganden Tripa at that time, said to his friends, "Understanding His Holiness the Dalai Lama's teachings is challenging because his way of presenting the material is special. He touches on this point and that, but we are unable to integrate everything into the traditional framework of the teachings." I wonder if this is praise or criticism. In any case, please think deeply about the various topics in the manner explained. Contemplate how these topics relate to one another and to your life. Bhikṣu Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama, Thekchen Choling. Preface by Bhikṣuṇī Thubten Chodron. The purpose of this series. Everything comes about due to causes and conditions, and this series is no exception. Explaining some of its causes and conditions will help you understand the purpose of this series. Its ultimate purpose is to lead you, the reader, and other sentient beings to full awakening. Although many excellent works on the stages of the path, the Lam Rim, already exist, there is a need for this unique series. To explain why, I will share a little of my personal story, which is typical of the first generation of Westerners encountering Tibetan Buddhism. Born in the United States, I grew up in a Judeo-Christian culture. I tried to believe in God, but that worldview didn't work for me. There were too many unanswered questions. When I was 24, I attended a 3-week Dharma course taught by 2 Tibetan lamas. One of the first things they said was, "You don't have to believe anything we say. You're intelligent people. Examine these teachings using reasoning. Practice them and see through your own experience if they work. Then decide if you want to adopt them." The attitude of ehipashika, or come and see, that the Buddha spoke about in the sutras, attracted me. Studying, contemplating, and practicing the Buddha's teachings over time, I became convinced that this path made sense and would help me if I practiced it sincerely. Like many young Westerners in the 1970s, I steeped myself in studying and practicing Tibetan Buddhism as best I could, considering that I didn't know the Tibetan language or much about Tibetan culture. Our Dharma education commenced with the Lamrim, a genre of texts that lead readers through the progressive stages of the path to awakening. Here, it is helpful to look at the place of Tibetan Lamrim works within the tradition. After the Buddha's awakening, he taught across India for 45 years. Sensitive to the needs, interests, and dispositions of the various audiences, he gave teachings that were appropriate for them at that moment. After his passing, parinirvana, the great Indian sages organized the material in the sutras by topic points and wrote treatises and commentaries explaining these. After the Dharma spread to Tibet, Tibetan masters also wrote treatises and commentaries, of which Lamrim literature is one type. Tibetans see this development of treatises, commentaries, and commentaries on commentaries as a demonstration of the sages' kindness. The fortunate ones who were direct disciples of the Buddha had great merit and could attain realizations of the path without needing lengthy teachings. Since those of future generations had less merit, their minds were not as sharp, and they required more detailed explanations to dispel their doubts, generate the correct views, and attain realizations. Since people's minds are even more obscured and they have less merit now, new commentaries are needed. Our teachers thus said the sutras are like freshly picked cotton, the Indian treatises and commentaries like woven cloth, and the Lamrim texts like ready-made clothes. When the first generation of Westerners were introduced to the Lamrim, we were told that everything we needed to know was in these texts, and that all we had to do to gain awakening was study and practice them correctly over time. However, things didn't turn out to be that simple. From the very beginning of the Lamrim, we had doubts about topics that, for our Tibetan teachers, were obvious. Precious Human Life, one of the initial meditations of the Lamrim, speaks of our fortune of being born as human beings, not as hell beings, hungry ghosts, or animals. Tibetans, raised in a culture that believes in rebirth and various realms of existence, accept this without question. However, for those of us raised in Christian, Jewish, or secular cultures that respect science, this is not the case. Furthermore, while our Tibetan teachers talked about all phenomena being empty of true existence, we were wondering, does God exist? When they taught selflessness, we were trying to find our souls as our true selves. When they explained dependent arising, we were seeking the one absolute truth independent from all else. Philosophically, our views did not coincide. The traditional presentation of the teachings assumed that the audience had faith in the Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, and was free from doubts about religious institutions and issues around authority. The teachings were directed toward people who could separate their emotional needs from their spiritual practice, and who would correctly understand the teachings. For example, they assumed we would not be overwhelmed with guilt when reflecting on our harmful actions. We would not harshly criticize ourselves when contemplating the disadvantages of self-centeredness, and we would not succumb to our culture's tendency to idolize the charismatic. From our side, we Westerners assumed that all Tibetan teachers were Buddhas, and that the values we grew up holding, democracy, gender equality, care for the environment, and so on, would be perfectly embodied in Tibetan society. All these assumptions on both sides were incorrect. And after a while, many Westerners began to have difficulties with their Dharma studies and practices. The cultural difference was difficult for us and for our spiritual mentors, who were doing their best to teach people whose perspective on life was totally new to them. It took many years for all of us to realize that Westerners require pre-Lamrim teachings. For us to grow in the Dharma, the stages of the path need to commence with material that meets our dispositions. His Holiness the Dalai Lama understood this and adjusted his teachings in the West accordingly. Instead of beginning with a reliance upon a spiritual mentor elevated to the status of a Buddha, he started with the two truths: how things appear to exist, and how they actually exist. Rather than tell us that reciting a certain mantra a few times would protect us from rebirth in the hells, he explained the four truths of the Aryas, those who non-conceptually perceive ultimate reality. Instead of saying that drinking blessed water would purify eons of destructive karma, he taught us about the nature of the mind, the workings of the mental afflictions, and the possibility of attaining liberation. Diving into the philosophy that underlies the Buddhist worldview, he asked us to think deeply about it. He challenged us to doubt our anger and to open our hearts with compassion for all sentient beings. His was a no-nonsense approach, and when he learned that, contrary to Buddhist scriptures, the earth was not flat and revolved around the sun, he was quick to say that if science conclusively proves something, we should accept it and not adhere to scriptural pronouncements to the contrary. In this environment, in 1993, I requested an interview with His Holiness. The interview did not happen for another 2 years due to His Holiness's full schedule. During the interview, I humbly requested him to write a short Lamrim text designed for non-Tibetans, a text that Tibetan geshes could use to teach Westerners. It would present the topics in an order suitable for people who did not grow up Buddhist and would deal with doubts and issues that non-Tibetans had about the Dharma. His Holiness agreed with the idea, but he immediately stipulated that a larger commentary should be written first and then points extracted from it to make a root text. He asked me to speak to senior Dharma students about the topics to include, gave me a transcript of a Lamrim teaching he had recently given to use as a foundation, and asked me to begin. I spoke with many senior Western practitioners and assembled a list of questions, topics, issues, and doubts that they would like His Holiness to address. Over the ensuing years, I met with His Holiness several times to address these topics and to show him the work I had done so far on the manuscript. In our time together, he taught specific subjects upon my request, offered deeper explanations of others, and answered the many questions that I had accumulated. He seemed to thoroughly enjoy these sessions and usually invited other geshes and his brother to come. I would ask a question, and they discussed the answer animatedly in Tibetan, with His Holiness asking the geshes what they thought, bringing up points they had not considered. After some time, the translator gave me the conclusion of the discussion. As I continued to add more material from many of His Holiness's oral teachings and from our interviews, the manuscript became larger and larger. I came to see that the purpose of this series was to fill the gap between the short Lamrim texts with teachings lamas gave in the West and the long philosophical treatises translated into English by scholars. Western practitioners needed a concise presentation in their own language of the major topics in the philosophical texts that could also be the basis for an analytical meditation on the Lamrim. In 2003, I began to read the manuscript aloud for His Holiness so he could check it. We soon realized that this would be a lengthy process that his schedule did not permit. In 2004, he asked his translator, Geshe Dorje Damdul, to go through.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.